So to start with, I'd like to introduce Ruth Ormston and Jamie Bristow, the authors of the Mindfulness in Westminster report. Ruth is the outgoing director of the Mindfulness Initiative and has been the main liaison for the Mindfulness All-Party Parliamentary Group. Ruth is also a founding member of the UK's Mindfulness in Law Group. Jamie was the director of the Mindfulness Initiative between 2015 and 2023, staying on as a policy expert on climate and sustainability matters. Jamie has authored a number of influential publications on mindfulness and works with decision makers around the world to integrate inner capacities and contemplative practice into public realm. Jamie currently leads on policy and advocacy for the inner development goals. So as two previous directors of the Mindfulness Initiative, huge shoes for me to fill, but I would like to welcome them and ask them, starting with Ruth, to talk about the report for us.
Thank you very much, Richard. Thank you. And thank you, everybody, for being here tonight. It's lovely to see you all. So our report is really the culmination of around 10 years of teaching mindfulness within the UK Parliament. And the Mindfulness Initiative itself has never taught the mindfulness programme, but it has clerked the all-party parliamentary group on mindfulness that has looked at questions of policy and how the evidence base for mindfulness might potentially meet particular policy concerns. But our report itself starts with a very important question from Baroness Ruth Lister, who's a member of the Mindfulness All Party Parliamentary Group, and stated, "We talk about mindfulness being helpful out there, but what about how mindfulness could help in here in Parliament? What about mindful politics?" And this report is our attempt to really start to look at that question, drawing on reflections given in around 20 interviews, as well as comments made elsewhere by politicians. We start to look at how mindfulness has helped politicians personally, how it's impacted their relationships with others, the potential implications for mindfulness in political culture, and then where we actually go next. And it's important to note that although many of the findings align with existing research that we have in mindfulness from neuroscience and leadership development, we felt when we were writing this report that it was really important to put things in the politicians' own words, so to actually draw directly from the interviews and from conversations that we've had with them. So in the next few minutes, I'm going to share those reflections and hopefully just give you a flavour of what the report covers. It's free to download from our website, so please do go there if you'd like to look at it in more detail. And when I presented on this report at the physical launch in Parliament, I remember telling everybody that when I was little, my parents, when I told them that I wanted to be a politician when I was older, said that they didn't think I should do that because people aren't very nice to them. And that was really in the back of my mind as I was writing this report, because one of the things that really drew out of it was the politician's own particular kind of personal benefit that they got from just taking the time to pause throughout their day and from experiencing mindfulness practice. Turning to well-being and performance then, it brings out some of the very practical elements that politicians use from their practice when they're working within Westminster. Some politicians spoke of it helping with specific mental health issues such as depression, and others spoke more widely of it helping them manage stress, manage busy work schedules, prioritise task lists, be more focused and effective in meetings and in public speaking. And those who spoke of it being making them more efficient generally also made the point that there was a depth and a quality to the task that they were undertaking, and that there was a positive relationship on that, as well as a positive impact on, say, the duration. So Conservative Member of Parliament, former Minister for Sport, Tracy Crouch, reflected that mindfulness made meetings more efficient, but instead of saying, "I'm sorry, I didn't quite understand," i.e. I wasn't listening, "I'm more fully focused." In terms of resilience, weekly mindfulness drop-in classes that take place in Westminster were described in the interviews with politicians as being a respite, an oasis in the desert, enabling people to return to their parliamentary business feeling stronger, better energised, and more hopeful. And Baroness Doreen Lawrence reminds us of the simplicity but powerful opportunity that mindfulness gives us to just pause in our day, saying, "Mindfulness allows me to step into the moment and be present, and the importance of doing that should not be underestimated. Or as Baroness Doreen Massey puts it, I can breathe in the middle of a sentence. I can actually stop. And there was a recognition amongst politicians about how mindfulness might be seen as a soppy option. But as Baroness Elizabeth Andrews states, we need to talk to both houses about how effective mindfulness can be, and that it isn't just some sloppy option. It's a very serious opportunity to take stock and to develop resilience and emotional understanding. So whilst the public and the media might show little interest or perhaps even sympathy for resilience of our leaders and decision makers, I think expecting them perhaps just to get on with it, these reflections of politicians being able to pause, being able to focus better, being able to deal with the frenetic pace of their day, makes a compelling case for the importance of supporting their resilience and performance through tools such as mindfulness. Because in an era where we're expecting our leaders to make decisions on urgent, complex matters that impact all of our futures, why wouldn't we equip them with emotional, cognitive tools to support their individual well-being and to be able to focus better on what they're doing when they're doing it, with an attitude of curiosity, awareness, and care? And those attitudes of awareness and care seem to have impacted not only politicians' relationship to their own experience within Westminster, but also to their relationships with others. And we highlight in our report the reflections politicians give on mindfulness enabling them to respond more creatively to challenging situations rather than simply reacting impulsively. As Chris Rowan, who was really instrumental in introducing mindfulness into Parliament, notes as part of his reflections, it's a blessed gift to be able to create that half a second difference between an immediate reaction and a response. Others speak of mindfulness helping them to listen more effectively to others, take on board concerns, see other perspectives, and be better able to navigate disagreement. Baroness Anna Healy reflects that through her mindfulness practice, she's much more able to step back and see the other point of view. And it's worth noting that although these benefits are in part attributed to mindfulness, politicians we spoke to also place huge importance on the fact they're able to undertake the training and practice together as a group with guidance from a skilled teacher. So one of the recommendations towards the back of our report is to provide a dedicated physical space for this group practice to continue. And politicians speak of the way in which this practice, this group setting, and this expert teaching helps them to support one another and see each other as human beings, regardless of political persuasion. As one Labour MP put it, it's quite strange to meet your opponents in a more benign climate, which has a different sort of character that is not about having a go at each other. And these are the insights that I found personally to be the most inspiring, because they serve as an important reminder to all of us that, in the words of one parliamentarian, underneath all that nonsense going on, you have the same pain, the same anxieties, the same worries, and the same everything we all have. And what's even more interesting in the report is that some politicians feel this relationship with others extends beyond their immediate practice group to friends, families, constituents, and other colleagues within Westminster. When speaking of the contribution that mindfulness training has made to their perception of those with opposing views, for example, one politician speaks of it helping to remove mental and psychological barriers that we place when we construct our enemies, reflecting that it's just at that moment we're in different positions and those positions will change. And there are reflections from many who speak of a politics based on greater respect, thoughtfulness, and even kindness. And kindness is a word that came up a number of times in the interviews held. It's not a word we perhaps naturally associate with politics, but it's something that lends itself to including and respecting different views, perspectives, and lived experiences in order to come up with more effective solutions to some of the most complex and challenging issues that we face. So we're not saying mindfulness is the only solution here, but what we are saying is that investing in the inner development of our politicians and our decision makers through evidence-based psychological training for their own mental health, for their performance and effectiveness, and for the contribution it could make, could be in all of our interests. So rather than seeing mindfulness just something that needs to be under the radar or needs to be justified, we should perhaps be encouraging politicians and leaders to connect with themselves and each other in this way, to connect with their hearts as well as their heads, through practices such as mindfulness. As Sir Alan Howarth, who we quote at the very end of our report, observes, the mutual respect, the willingness to listen, the kindness, the open-minded seeking after better understanding that mindfulness helps inculcate, these are the crucial underpinnings for a better politics. So hopefully that gives you a flavour of some of the individual, personal and interpersonal benefits that politicians reflect on within this report. I want to give a shout out before I hand over to Jamie to Dr. Otto Simonson, who conducted the interviews for us with such skill and such depth. But without further ado, I'm now going to hand over to Jamie, who's going to look at some of the insights that were given on culture within Westminster and the wider picture. Thank you, Jamie.
And thank you very much, Ruth, and everyone else for your time and attention this evening for this, I think, fundamentally important conversation about how we support our public leaders to make crucial decisions on our behalf in amidst bewildering complexity that's only going to get trickier as the century unfolds. So as Ruth has mentioned, many of those who have had some mindfulness training, those 300 MPs and members of the House of Lords, quickly found some personal benefit, often a kind of self-regulation benefit, concentrating better or sleeping better, etc. And then over the weeks and months, noticing interpersonal impacts, as well as within Parliament. You know, I remember Desmond Swain saying that a member of Parliament saying that it was his wife who noticed the most benefit, and when he sort of considered he might drop it, his wife said, "No, you won't." There are these personal interpersonal benefits became clear, I think, within the first year or two of this training being available. But it took some years for MPs and peers to start putting their finger on what might the wider implications be for the culture of politics within Westminster. And perhaps one of the first to mention something in this direction was Lord Andrew Stone, who described, first of all, that interpersonally, you know, was meeting people who had been on the course within the corridors of power, there was a slightly different tone to their discussions. They included more of themselves, he said, within their conversations, by which I mean, like, you know, more of their humanity rather than just their job role. But when other politicians who hadn't been on the course came to join their conversation, there was a noticeable sort of, you know, melding of tones or meeting of this sort of new way of talking. And this is something that's actually been picked up in a corporate context as well, that sometimes there's this halo effect that goes beyond the potentially minority groups who are engaging in daily practice to actually influencing wider culture. We shouldn't overstate this. I think that those insights I'll share with now are really good news. And when you talk to people about how politicians are practicing mindfulness and saying how this is changing the way in which they do politics, often, you know, understandably met with disbelief or laughter, because that's not the story that is told on TV, of course. And particularly the sound bites that are needed for social media. There are various pressures, social media pressures, which mean that we get potentially, you know, only a partial picture. And there's lots of really great collegiate and collaborative action behind the scenes that mindfulness could, in some small way, already be supporting. And yes, after Andrew's first intuitions about this kind of halo effect, it was, as Ruth mentioned, it was Baroness Ruth Lister in sort of 2017 who said, at an event we ran, "What about mindfulness in here? What about mindful politics?" And around a sort of similar time, Tim, who we'll hear Tim Loughton, who we'll hear more from in a moment, noticed that there was an affinity amongst those who have been on this mindfulness course, and a rather more considered approach to exchanges of differing views. In the foreword to this report, him and Jess Morden used the phrase helping politicians to disagree better, which I think is a really helpful catchphrase for what we need to see in a number of ways. So this third chapter of our report, focusing on the potential cultural implications, is broken into three sections. The first is looking at mindfulness in the debating chamber itself, or rather the impact of mindfulness in the debating chamber itself. And Tim is one of those who said that this has been noticeable, that there has been a noticeable difference. Tim, we haven't actually spoken about this before, but I was quite impressed by something that you did within a Brexit debate that was extremely, it was a heated room, let's put it like this, and people were kind of baying for blood or to raise the pressure even higher, and you stood up and paused for a beat and then just asked for calm. You just said, like, calm, before you then calmly gave your question, and it really, I think, changed the tenor of discourse in the subsequent sort of half an hour or so. And I think that was a really concrete example of how, you know, maybe you might disagree, but I would see that that was a mindful moment, a collective mindful moment that you brought to everybody. And here we have Chris Rowan's another who says that his behavior has transformed over the years, that he was perhaps one of the more disruptive in the chamber, and it was even sort of mentioned in the press as such. But then called out by the celebrated, in fact, by the Speaker of the House of Commons for being a practitioner of mindfulness himself, because he's a much more calm and phlegmatic fellow these days, in the words of John Burko. So, in the words of another politician interviewed here, they speak of mindfulness being so powerful in reminding me that I'm dealing with other human beings. It helps me to remove the mental constructs and psychological barriers that we place to construct our enemies. Actually, I think Ruth mentioned this one. Another saying that they used to call out people on a gratuitous basis, but after practicing mindfulness, still call out people when they need to be disagreed with, but do it in a perhaps a more respectful way. That's the kind of impact in the most visible way, perhaps, in the debating chamber. Our second section looks at something which is sort of has had an insidious effect on our body politic more widely, perhaps particularly within the political context of Westminster, and that's our sort of tendency towards tribalism and polarization, and the potential for mindfulness, the capacity of mindfulness for mindfulness practice to ameliorate that somewhat. So these dynamics have serious negative implications for our collective decision making, but it's also just a horrendous way to live. And those interviewed often describe how this environment is aggressive, hostile, and tough to live in. And it's perhaps no wonder that a couple of the most prominent female leaders of recent times, Jacinda Ardern and Nicola Sturgeon, both referred to the brutality of politics and reminded people that they were human beings. In fact, there's evidence that these kind of cultures have an impact, negative impact, on diversity within the workplace. So it's worth mentioning, I think, the word polarization can mean a couple of different things. So firstly, there's polarization of opinions, of views, and in the words of Desmond Swain, mindfulness doesn't make him any less ideological, doesn't necessarily mean that you disagree less about what you think should happen in society. We want disagreement. Disagreement is healthy, but there's a different sort of polarization, which is affective polarization, and that is the extent to which we dislike, distrust, or outright hate people who have different views to us. And so we can reduce affective polarization without necessarily changing stances on views, although actually through dialogue our views might converge on a helpful, wholesome middle ground in some cases. And so early work, particularly from Otto Simonson, who worked with us on this piece of work, early research is pointing to mindfulness actually reducing affective polarization, so the extent to which we dislike or distrust those we disagree with. And so in the words of in the words of one member of the House of Lords, mindfulness has allowed people in Parliament to work with greater compassion, understanding and patience. And I've noticed that even those who haven't been on the course sometimes adapt to the new tone when joining conversations between those who have. So yeah, echoing other comments there I made earlier. The final section then, I won't steal Caroline's thunder too much, because I know she's going to hopefully mention this. But one of the things underpinning reduction in affective polarization might be this, what we sometimes call metacognitive awareness, or our ability to see our thoughts and ideas in a bit of perspective and be less identified with our views, so that when our views are challenged, they are less, it's less like we're under personal attack. The other thing that that Caroline said at the launch in Parliament is around values and the ability, the capacity of mindfulness helping us to stay more of the time attuned to what is most important to us. And so I'll just finish then this section with words from Lady Parmenter, Member of the House of Lords, who says, "Mindfulness encourages you to take a moment to reflect and think about others, not just in terms of other beings, but in terms of the earth which we are part of. I'm not claiming that mindfulness will turn you into the next Greta Thunberg, but it might create the space in you to think a little more openly about how you interact with other people and other things." So as Ruth mentioned, this, I think, is a call for us to take the mental health, the inner resources of our leaders seriously. And sort of showing that there are ways in which we can do this in an evidence-based manner, because our collective well-being and the direction of our nation, of our society, is dependent upon the emotional, cognitive and relational capacities of very few people, this select group, and it makes very good sense for us to invest in those capacities for our own good. All right, thank you. Ruth, am I back over to Richard now?
Yes, I think it's back to me. Thank you, Jamie. Thank you, Ruth and Jamie. That was great. We've got a couple of questions come through already. We're going to save the questions to the end, if that's okay. But if things do come to mind as we go through, please put things in the chat and we will pick them up at the end. We just want to maximize the amount of time we have for feedback from you all when we get to the end. That's great. So we now move over to Tim Loughton MP. Tim was first elected to Parliament in 1997 as member for East Worthing and Shoreham, and has been re-elected 6 times since then. Prior to Parliament, Tim worked in the private sector as a fund manager in the City of London before becoming a director at Fleming Private Asset Management. Tim has held various positions during his time in Parliament. He's been the Shadow Minister for Environment, the Shadow Minister for Health and Children. He previously served as the Parliamentary Undersecretary for Children, leading on several areas of successful reform in child protection, child sexual exploitation and adoption in particular. From the backbenches, Tim continues to work vigorously in support of improving the life and chances of children and young people and making sure their voices are heard in Parliament. He also sits on the influential Home Affairs Select Committee, as well as continuing as Vice Chair of the Local Government Association. Tim is an advisory board member for the Conservatives Against Racism for Equality and Chairman of the Conservative Party Human Rights Commission. Tim chairs, co-chairs, and is a vice chair on a number of all-party parliamentary groups. And we're really pleased that Tim, and a little bit amazed that Tim has the time and the capacity, but he manages to find it, to be the co-chair of the Mindfulness All-Party Parliamentary Group. So Tim, thank you for speaking this evening.
Richard, thank you very much. I think the reason I find time for it is because I do mindfulness, which puts things into perspective and keeps me much more leveled and balanced. But welcome, everybody. This is a fantastic global reach, this report and this seminar today has got. I see from people in the chat, we have people from quite a few continents: Chile, California, Washington, Sweden, Barbados. So it's good evening, good afternoon, and good morning, wherever you are amongst those. But it's great to have such a good audience. And I want to start by thanking the Mindfulness Initiative for making what we're discussing today really possible over the last 10 years by their support for mindfulness, coming to Parliament with their mindfulness expertise and supporting us as the secretariat to the all-party group, which we set up almost 10 years ago. And I want to pay particular tribute to Jamie, who started it, Ruth, who carried it on and picked up the baton, and now welcome Richard, who was thrown in at the deep end with the official launch in Parliament just a few weeks ago as his first day. So we've been really well supported, and it's without that we just couldn't have produced this report, but everything that goes with it. And I just want to really put this into context. So the all-party group was set up back in 2014 by Lord Layard, a Labour peer, a renowned economist, but particularly somebody who has made a reputation in what I call the economics of happiness and well-being, a real expert and advocate in this whole area around mental health. Together with, as Jamie mentioned, Chris Rowan, a Labour MP, who had a reputation for being a bit shouty, we say, in the chamber, and they came together really cross-party. This Tracy Crouch, Conservative MP, still in Parliament, former sports minister, a real advocate for mindfulness, who I seem to recall commented that it helped her through her pregnancy. She was pregnant whilst a parliamentarian, and certainly she also said it helped her get pregnant, but that's probably too much information as she gave us at the time when we launched a previous report. And then there was Lauralee Burt, now Baroness Burt in the House of Lords, a Liberal Democrat peer. So what's really important about this is it entirely is cross party, and we all come together as human beings who happen to be parliamentarians from whatever political affiliation we have, and that's been an important part of it. We then set up these mindfulness sessions so that MPs and members of the House of Lords could actually see from a personal practical experience what mindfulness was all about and how it might impact on us to do our jobs better. And to date, I think now it's well over 300 MPs and members of the House of Lords have been through a mindfulness course. And importantly as well, it's extended to staff members, over 800 members of staff at Westminster. And there's something of a waiting list, I think, from going on the mindfulness courses. And it's part of the wellbeing programme now offered within Parliament. So I think it's really important Parliament has taken this seriously and is leading by example. It's not just something we discuss and other people do. It's something we discuss because we've done it. We know how it helps us, and we want to widen its appeal and its application to as many of our constituents as possible. So it's absolutely not a soppy option, as Ruth was alluding to earlier. But many people came to it as skeptics. I have to say it was relatively new to me, and I came to it thinking, okay, what's all this about? Went along to a series of classes and absolutely got it, and it has benefited me. So I'm living proof, and I've lasted almost 27 years as an MP, and probably those last 10 years I wouldn't have lasted if it wasn't for the help of keeping you balanced with being able to have access to mindfulness and all it stands for. And absolutely, it's not an exaggeration what Jamie has just said, that it has improved the level and standard or and tenor of debate in the House of Commons chamber, which can be a fairly unforgiving and combative place at times, not least in the post-Brexit anarchy, as I would call it, where Parliament in the UK was not a happy place. I mean, I freely admit there were several cold winter's mornings when I really didn't want to crawl out from underneath my duvet to go into the office to see what on earth was going to happen this particular day in Parliament. And having recourse to, well, hold on, this isn't what life's all about. There are releases, there are ways that we can ground ourselves. And the mindfulness courses during that Brexit anarchy, I think, were particularly popular as people tried to re-engage with some degree of sanity and normality. Now, back in 2015, I was looking at some of our earlier reports. So this is the report which hopefully everybody has seen, which we launched officially in the Speaker's House, very prestigious, a few weeks ago in the House of Commons. And I was looking through one of the early reports we produced, which was the Mindful Nation UK, which we produced back in 2015, 8 years ago, with an introduction by Jess Morden, who's a Labour MP and again my co-chair of the Mindfulness All Party group. And what we did at that stage was to hold a series of hearings, which culminated in that report, to see how mindfulness had application, was working, and had potential, particularly in four areas. And they were health, the health service, in education and in schools, in the workplace, and how employers, certainly progressive employers, were beginning to adopt this because they saw the advantages it had for their workforce, and also in the criminal justice system and some experiments that were taking place in one prison in Peterborough, in particular in the UK. So we produced the Mindful Nation UK report, data rich, some really good evidential facts in there. This isn't just a concept that we talk in woolly terms about. We wanted to see how it was actually working already in those particular areas. The foreword was by Professor John Kabat-Zinn, the great guru of mindfulness from Massachusetts University. So it had top level endorsement as well. And just looking at some of the recommendations and observations we made at that stage, we were keen that NICE, which is the National Institute for Clinical Excellence, who makes decisions over drugs and treatments available within the National Health Service, should pick this up and should give guidance about how the NHS should commission this for that stage, something like almost 600,000 adults within the UK who are at risk of recurrent depression, and how also we could improve access to psychological therapies, including mindfulness. And I'm glad to say subsequently, NICE issued those guidelines. NICE have formally recognised some of the things that we have been saying. We've still got quite a long way to go, but it's got the endorsement of effectively that very important body that oversees our health service. In education, I was a former Minister for Education, Minister for Children, and Shadow Minister for Mental Health. So I'm more than many perhaps conscious of the huge stresses and impacts on the mental health of our children. That has certainly got far worse since the COVID lockdown and the impact on children of closing schools had. And so we made recommendations about how the Department for Education could designate teaching schools to develop innovation, how we should train more teachers in mindfulness. And this has resulted in mindfulness schools. And what's really important about mindfulness schools is it's a whole school approach. Too much in the past where you have children who have behavioural problems, children who may have low-level mental illness problems, it may be down to poor attachment at birth. There's a very close correlation between parents going through perinatal mental illness problems and the impact that that has on attachment dysfunction leading into later childhood of children. What's really important is mindfulness in schools is something that is fun to do, everybody wants to do is not stigmatizing and not judgmental, whereas before it might just be a few individuals who are sort of hauled out to do special classes with a psychologist, whatever it is. The whole school does the mindfulness practice from which everybody benefits, whatever level of low-key mental illness you may have or not. So it's the non-judgmental, non-stigmatizing element of mindfulness, which is really, I think, relevant and beneficial for schools. We then looked at the workplace, and some of the bigger employers in the UK have already adopted it because they see that a happy workforce is a more productive and loyal workforce as well. There's a real mutual benefit from looking after your workforce, and mindfulness is something that is easy to deliver in the mainstream. So we urged the what was then the Department for Business, Innovation and Skills to give a lead. It certainly helps if government departments adopt it and that they're taking it seriously for their own staff, because why would other businesses or other public services do so if the lead department of government isn't actually taking it seriously. We urged the What Work Centre for Wellbeing from the Department of Industry to extend applications for mindfulness around various other public sector programmes as well. And then in justice, again, we met, I remember a fascinating crowded meeting where a former convict who had spent a lot of his life in jail, had been through all sorts of rehabilitation programs, none of which have worked. And then he alighted upon mindfulness. And he said it was the one thing which had actually got him literally back on the straight and narrow, was a major advocate for it. And so certainly there are applications within the criminal justice system where there's evidential basis for why it can work. So those were the basis, the recommendations in that Mindful Nation report 8 years ago. Subsequently, we've looked into other areas, particularly defence. And we had a really interesting meeting with some very senior members of the armed forces, came to a big cinema in Parliament. And it was based on the experience of the US SEALs, where they had introduced mindfulness into some of their training and shown it was very successful. And they so picked this up that mindfulness training is part of the training that the Army gets at Sandhurst, for example, and they've put it on their curriculum. And the Army was one of the biggest enthusiasts about the whole mindfulness experience. And it was really great to see the key part that we played in making that in that link. So we haven't just been a talking shop in the all-party group. We have been overseeing, with the help of the Mindfulness Initiative and various other academics who've come our way, producing good, solid evidence and experiences and practical applications of how mindfulness can help so many different sectors of our community. In 2016, we produced this report on building the case for mindfulness in the workplace, and certainly the number of businesses which have now adopted mindfulness for their workforce has accelerated hugely. And another thing we had, which I think stood out, and you're going to hear from Tim Ryan, who was part of this earlier back in October 2017, we brought together parliamentarians from, I think, about 14 different parliaments, 14 different countries, over 40 MPs, all converged on Westminster. John Cabot-Zim, again, was here as our keynote speaker, to share their experiences of how mindfulness was now happening in their own parliaments, helped in part by Chris Rowan and parliamentarians in the UK that we went out to help some of these parliaments who are interested in adopting it and to see the impact that it had on them. I remember it created quite a lot of attention at the time for all the wrong reasons, because I was asked to give the vote of thanks to John Cabot-Zim. And I casually mentioned that the great thing about mindfulness is you can do it any place, anytime, anywhere. And that I tended to do my mindfulness in my bath in the morning, where I also tend to, when I was a minister, I went through the contents of my red box. And so my staff would always know I'd actually read the papers, because they're all a bit crinkly from the steam in the bath. Now, this was a sort of bit of a throwaway comment, but it had an important application, because mindfulness is not something you need to be sitting in front of a clinical psychologist or a practitioner to do. It is something you can do at your own ease in the most appropriate place. And for me, it just happens to be lying horizontal for quite a while, first thing in the morning. Whereupon the headlines of the Times the following day, because there have been some journalists in the audience, was Conservative MP spends an hour in the bath every morning thinking about things. And it was a big cartoon to go with it. Now, I took one for the team there, but I was happy to do so because actually it gave a huge amount of publicity to mindfulness and what politicians were doing and taking it seriously, that I think it benefited in promoting what we were trying to do. And I think I made a solid case for why, if you order yourself at the beginning of the day with the help of mindfulness, put everything into perspective, and you go into the office calm, collected, and having an idea of what you want to do, rather than going to the office yawning all over the place and wondering what on earth is going to hit you when you open the door, you are going to be more productive. You are going to have a better day at work. You are going to interact with your colleagues in a more beneficial way. So the fact that I spend an hour in the bath most mornings, in which I include my mindfulness routine, is fine by me, appearing on the front page of the London Times. So this report, I think, was a natural extension of what we had been doing. We were promoting how mindfulness had these applications to so many of our constituents, to companies, organizations within our constituencies. It was only right that we should effectively fess up as to how it's impacted on us as politicians. And there's been a huge mindset shift in the now 26 and a half years I've been in Parliament, where for an MP to get up in the chamber and say he or she has got a mental illness problem and want to talk about it openly, never happened 25 years ago. There was stigma attached. If an MP had got up to say, I'm suffering from mental illness, there was a very real fear that people would say, well, we don't want somebody who's got a mental illness to be serving as our MP. Clearly, they're not suitable to be an MP. In the last few years, and I have no doubt that the mindfulness initiative and what we've done around mindfulness for low-level mental health issues has encouraged and made a safe space for parliamentarians who are suffering from a mental illness. Why wouldn't they? We are humans like anybody else, to get up in Parliament to say, this has been my experience. And it's so much better informing debates when we are having debates around everyday experiences of all our constituents in coping with the everyday pressures of life. And we are in a particularly high stress, high pressure, and very extraordinary job, which is why it's so extraordinary that Ruth wanted to be a politician when she was an impressionable youngster a few years ago. So the report, I think, is really good in giving honest, clear, forthright individual testimonies from everyday serving MPs and members of the Lord, saying that it has made us feel more relaxed, more productive in our job, that we can take a step back from all those negative pressures swirling around us in our job every day, to step back from the stressful diaries and stressful program that we have just for a little while, to reground ourselves and then move ahead in a more orderly fashion, that we can focus on the meetings we're sitting in and not let it all go over our heads, that we can focus on the task in hand. But also, as Jamie really pointed out, that it helps with relationships. Despite the huge political differences we have between our parties, we're certainly not looking to resolve those political differences, but we are looking to understand them across the chamber rather better, and to respect them rather than retreat, such an easy and lazy retreat into tribalism, which so often dominates politics. And again, as Ruth said, to demonstrate a bit of kindness as well. 650 MPs in the House of Commons from a dozen or so different parties. Caroline, you're about to hear from us from the Green Party, although she's a one-woman show. There's only one Green member, but there's a huge variety of different opinions. But we're all trying to do the same job, and we all have the same objective and interests in trying to get a better deal for our constituents and our country at the end of the day. And we don't have to be beastly to each other in order to achieve that. So we are certainly, I think, getting a more considered and measured response from people who've been through the mindfulness course. And particularly, it's helped us, as I called it, through the post-Brexit anarchy period that we've experienced in the UK, whatever side of the Brexit argument we might have been on. So the phrase which Jamie quoted earlier, to put it in a nutshell, it's about disagreeing better. That means better bonding with our fellow politicians, better respect, greater inclusivity as well. And the whole point of this is to make mindfulness mainstream. And if we can get politicians, a rare breed of extraordinary people doing an extraordinary job inexplicably in some cases, adopting, embracing, benefiting from mindfulness, then I don't see that there's any section of society that can't get something out of this as well. So that's what this report is all about. Mindfulness is something serious. It's something all of us can benefit from, in the same way as some people want to get physically fitter by going to the gym. We don't stigmatize that. So why would we stigmatize people who want to get fitter mentally from doing a simple, accessible exercise like mindfulness? So we can all step into the moment despite the swirling chaos of the world around us. So I'm really pleased with this report. I'm really grateful to Ruth and Jamie and Otto for putting it all together. But I think it's a great testament in the last 10 years' experience in the UK Parliament of mindfulness. And we need more people doing it in parliaments around the world, but in communities and societies around the world as well, because it's a good thing to do. Thank you very much. Back to you, Richard.
Thank you, Tim. I really appreciate that. I noticed we've got a number of questions coming through and we're eating through time, which is fine. I think we can probably stay on past 6:30 if people wish to do that for maybe 5 or 10 minutes if we need to get through the questions. I don't want us to feel anxious about having to rush through this, because I think this debate and this conversation is fundamentally really, really important. It's really important to British politics, and it's certainly important to the future of the Mindfulness Initiative and the way that we move forward after this report. So I'd like to welcome Caroline Lucas MP as the Green Party's first MP. Caroline has represented Brighton Pavilion since 2010. She was previously an MEP for 11 years, an Oxfordshire councillor, and has been both a party leader and co-leader. She's chair of the All-Party Parliamentary Group on Climate Change, co-chair of the APPGs on Limits to Growth and the Green New Deal, and active in the Refugee and Drug Reforms APPGs, alongside serving on Parliament's Environmental Audit Committee and on the UK Trade and Business Commission. Caroline is one of the Environment Agency's top 100 eco-heroes of all time, and in 2015 published Honourable Friends, Parliament and the Fight for Change. So thank you for speaking this evening, Caroline.
Thank you so much, Richard. And let me just start by echoing Tim's thanks to everyone involved in this webinar this evening, but also in our APPG and in the sessions that continue in Parliament that give MPs the opportunity to have a shared space to practice mindfulness. It really is massively, massively appreciated. So thank you for all that work. Thank you to Tim for his presentation. I, like many others, I'm sure, are still wondering about how his bathwater doesn't go cold, but that's probably something he can let us know in the questions afterwards. Listen, we are running over time, and I want to make sure there's ample time to hear from Tim Ryan and from the questions, so I'm going to be very brief. I'm delighted to be here and to have been asked to say a few words about mindfulness and political culture. And I guess the first thing I was going to say is that we should, notwithstanding everything that everyone else has said, with which I agree, but nonetheless, I do think we need to be careful about not overclaiming in this space. You know, the UK Parliament has a reputation for being a bit of a bear pit, and I would argue that in many ways it still is. And anyone who's tuned into the weekly Prime Minister Questions event over the past few months I think we'll conclude that we've still got a very long way to go. There is still plenty of Punch and Judy rhetoric. There's still plenty of shouting and mocking and undermining. So particularly for those people who are joining us from countries outside the UK, don't believe that we've all suddenly become, like monks and nuns. We haven't. But having said that, I do believe that when we have a politics that is becoming ever more polarized, where stoking culture wars is frankly raised to the level of political strategy, then mindfulness does have something incredibly important to offer. And very briefly, I just wanted to explain that for myself, I found it helpful to think about it in three ways. The first one we've touched on quite a bit already, and that is in terms of building personal resilience so that disagreement can happen without people feeling under personal attack. And the second one is around the opportunity that I think mindfulness gives us to get more in touch with our personal values and how that feeds through into our politics. And then thirdly and finally, I think mindfulness has a real role to play in terms of fostering interconnectedness. And I'll say just a few words about that. So on the first point, it is a central tenet of mindfulness that we are not our thoughts, and that there is a separation between who we are and what we happen to believe or think. And that goes as well for what other people think of us. Their opinions of us don't have to change who we essentially are. And I just think that the more we have a little bit more of a gap between people's identities and the beliefs they happen to hold or the thoughts they happen to think, then there is the potential, at least, for a politics based on greater respect and thoughtfulness, that we do have that choice in how we respond. And recognizing that, I think, is something that gives us a huge freedom. And in turn, I think it can foster resilience in the face of personal attacks and might help us to be more open to new ideas, to seeing different sides of an argument without feeling so directly threatened by other people's points of view. And if you don't feel threatened by their points of view, I think there's a good chance that you might just be more likely to engage constructively rather than resorting to knee-jerk reactions. I think it was Thoreau who said, "Could a greater miracle take place than for us to look through each other's eyes for an instant?" And I think that mindfulness can have a role in enabling us to do that by taking that moment between the provocation and our response, if you like. And so I do agree with those who've already said that this can help us to develop a better politics based on greater understanding, on greater cooperation, more listening, separating the person away from a set of beliefs that we may or may not disagree with. I've pondered a little bit about what the implications are of all that, and where it leaves us when it comes to what I would argue, at least, is a rightful place for anger from time to time. And maybe that's something we can explore in the questions afterwards, because I don't think that mindfulness suddenly means that we all agree or that we don't feel angry about positions and policies that are pursued that, in our view, of, let's say, rolling back environmental protections or increasing inequality. But it's about how we have those conversations, I guess. And that perhaps brings me to my second point, which is that for me, mindfulness has to be more than just learning to be a bit more civil to each other, or learning to be a little bit less stressed, or just being less shouty. Important though, perhaps some of those things are. In other words, I don't think it's just a transactional thing or an instrumental one. Personally, I think for me, mindfulness is about taking that time, that moment to be closer to being about a deeper shift in values. And one of the greatest outcomes that mindfulness practice brings for me is that it enables me to stay in touch, I think, with my values in the midst of all the noise and the distraction of political life, and crucially to respect the values of others. One little example, you know, I find it so dispiriting in politics, is how people, particularly on social media, are encouraged always to think the worst of you. You know, if there are a number of different interpretations that could be put on something that you've said or done that someone else disagrees with, they'll almost always pick the one is that is the least forgiving and the one that casts you in the worst possible light. And at that moment, I think the ability to breathe and to take a moment and to be clear in your own mind about what your values are and the rationale for what you did or said can, I think, literally be something of a lifetime, a lifeline, and is certainly, for me, a really important survival mechanism. And then my third point, which is that I think there is the potential, at least, for mindfulness to create the space and the moment for that wider appreciation of our interconnectedness, both to each other and also, crucially, to this, our one infinitely fragile, infinitely precious, life-giving planet. And anything right now that enables us to do that at this moment of such division between communities and such systematic destruction of our natural environment, I think, has to be an overwhelming priority. I think that sense that mindfulness can enable us to be present in the moment, to pay attention, and I have to say in parenthesis that I think paying attention is a vastly overlooked skill or quality. That opportunity to recognize, in the words of Chief Seattle, that whatever we do to the earth, we do to ourselves, and vice versa. Then that connection with the natural world, I think, is so important in terms of reconnecting with who we are ourselves, and also what our role is when it comes to taking care of our natural environment and recognizing that we are part of it, not separate from it, but literally intrinsically nature ourselves. I think all of that just might lead to better listening, to more kindness, to more open-mindedness, and just maybe to a better and more effective policy making as well.
Thank you, Caroline. We will move on now because we have lots of questions coming through, and I do want to give opportunity for those at the end. Please feel free to continue putting your questions in. We'll try and get through as many as we can. So our final speaker this evening is Tim Ryan. Tim Ryan passionately served as the working families, served the working families in Northeast Ohio's 13th Congressional District in the United States Congress for 20 years. He's largely credited with leading economic transformation of Northeast Ohio after years of disinvestment and neglect. Tim has been ahead of his time in promoting critical health and wellness initiatives, reforming food and agriculture systems, and highlighting alternatives to heal troubled veterans. He's the author of a book on the power of mindfulness, Healing America, How a Simple Practice Can Help Us Recapture the American Spirit, which I think was originally entitled A Mindful Nation, which was an inspiration to the work of the Mindfulness Initiative. Tim holds a law degree from the University of New Hampshire School of Law and a bachelor's degree in political science from Bowling Green State University in Bowling Green, Ohio. Part of Tim's focus today is advocating for and promoting alternative approaches to dealing with trauma within society. Tim lives in Ohio with his family, and I'm told that his hobbies include practicing hot yoga and playing golf, although I presume these aren't both at the same time, Tim. Welcome.
No, they do help each other, though. Well, thank you. I appreciate it. What a amazing series of presentations. I mean, I remember when Chris came to my office many, many years ago talking about this, and I remember the start of the initiative in Westminster, and to think about what's happening here 10 years later really is mind-blowing to me. So congratulations to everybody who has been a part of this movement, not only in the UK, but inspiring people around the world. And, you know, like many of the other parliamentarians here, you know, the politics obviously in the United States are pretty rough and tumble. I think we look across the pond and say, what is going on over there? And you look across the pond and say, what the hell is going on over there? So we are united in the chaos that we're all experiencing here. And I was a very similar journey of being in politics, being in Congress, traveling around Ohio, traveling around the United States, and really getting to the point where I was going to be burned out, and went to the Power of Mindfulness retreat that Jon Kabat-Zinn held in upstate New York, and it blew my mind. And I have been promoting this ever since. And so to have this camaraderie, I guess, that we all share here, and really putting a flag into the ground, whether you're liberal or conservative or labor or green, you know, whatever the case may be, we've got to join forces to continue to make this happen. And I don't think I'm going to say anything new here, but I do want to, you know, put a couple of points on, you know, what has already been said from a global perspective, is that we have people across the countries that we all live in, across the world, burnout, economic challenges, the issues of climate, all of the inequality, and all of the great challenges, artificial intelligence, machine learning, these things that we struggle to get our minds around. And we know that if we're operating from a fight or flight mode, that we're not going to be able to have the kind of conversations, the deep, thoughtful, complex conversations that we need to have in order to try to solve these problems. So we're here, I think, today really to celebrate this initiative, because we all know, those of us who practice politics and have for the last, you know, 20 or 30 years, we know that politics is downstream of culture. And so the issues that we deal with in politics are cultural issues that just manifest themselves in certain ways in the political system, the mistrust, the cynicism that the previous speaker mentioned. And I think if we operate from, and it's why I'm really excited about this, because this is saying we need to shift the culture. This isn't talking about a 10-point policy plan and education or healthcare, any of those things. This initiative is about shifting the culture, shifting the way that we are, shifting the way that we operate in the world. And it's recognizing what has also been mentioned here, and I think is the underlying problem and challenge that we have, and that's disconnection. We are disconnected from each other. Clearly, we see that every single day on the news, whether it's the CNN or BBC or whatever it may be. We are disconnected from each other, and we are disconnected from our nature, the nature that surrounds us, our planet. We've lost that connection as well, and that has, as we're learning more and more every single day, more effects on our health, because we're disconnected from the very nature that we come from. And I think most importantly, we're disconnected from ourselves. We're disconnected from what Jon Kabat-Zinn would say, the deepest parts of who we are, because we're rattling around so much in our own heads. We get disconnected from our bodies and from the deepest part of who we are. And that disconnection, and I think all three of those levels of disconnection, lead to the deaths of despair that we see. I know here in the United States, I know, you know, less about what's happening in the UK, but the addiction, suicide rates, teen suicide rates, you know, the mental health issues that we're dealing with, depression. And there are other issues too around food and other things that I think are contributing to that. But I think underlying all of this is the deep level of disconnection. So by us putting a flag in the ground here with the mindfulness initiative, and I chuckled a little bit when I just realized that it's TMI in the United States. If somebody tells you a little bit more than you want to know, you say TMI, too much information. And so we have way too much information. We have a society that thinks that one more data point, one more conference, one more, you know, book I have to read, and then that's going to solve the problem. And that's not where the problems lie. The problems lie in our emotional development, our emotional intelligence, being connected to the wisdom that got us to this position, and recognizing that all the information, all the data, all the websites, all the algorithms put us here. And so we're putting a flag in the ground to say, we recognize that that's not the solution. We recognize that re-engaging with the deepest and best parts of who we are, our fellow citizens, and the world and nature that's around us. That's the first big step. We can get around to arguing about the 10-point policy plans, but we've got to get out of trauma. We've got to get out of fight or flight mode so that we can have some really honest and thoughtful conversations. And that's the art of politics. And so I'm just here to say thank you to everybody. And, you know, I'm going to enjoy the question and answer session, but know that when I was just lastly, I guess you should know, in the United States Congress, I happen to be chair of the committee that funds the legislative branch. And a few years ago, we literally started a health and wellness initiative with meditation and other, you know, forms of contemplative practice in the House of Representatives. I hope that can survive the current dramas that we're living through here in the last few weeks. But know that there are people here in the United States that want to join with you, not just me, but I'm clearly on board and look forward to what we can do together in the coming months and years. So thank you, everybody, for getting us to this point. And I will yield back the balance of my time.
Thank you, Tim. Really appreciate that. We do have a number of questions to get through, and I'm also conscious that Caroline has another meeting to go to at 6:30. So if I don't get a chance beforehand, thank you, Caroline, for your input this evening. If you're able to jump in between now and 6:30 to answer any of the questions that come forward, really appreciate that. But otherwise, thank you for your time. We really appreciate it. So I'll start with the first question, which is from Judith Soulsby. Thanks for a really interesting and heart-heartening report. I've only read half of it so far. In that first half, I don't see any negative responses to learning mindfulness in the research. I'm glad that there are so many positive benefits of learning mindfulness practice for legislators and staff, which seems to me essential. But I also wonder if any disbenefits or harms were asked about or were offered by those who are being interviewed. Ruth, would you like to come back on that very, very quickly?
Yeah, no problem. And I'm happy to answer this quite briefly because I've seen that we've got a lot of questions coming through. So no, not really, is the short answer to that question. But just bear in mind that this was quite a self-selecting group that gave interviews, in that it was people that we'd gone to from the all-party parliamentary group, so people who kept up their mindfulness practice clearly because they were finding some benefit from it and finding it useful. So one of our recommendations is for further research to be done within Parliament. Some of that research would be good to look at, you know, the people who didn't continue with their practice and why that was the case.
Thank you, Ruth. Second question was from Dr. Michael Craig Watson. How can we ensure that mindfulness reaches those individuals and places most in need, e.g. marginalised communities in places such as prisons, asylum centres and low-income neighbourhoods? This is something that I feel very, very strongly about. And I think if I can briefly answer that, I think this is an area which we need to do more work in with the Mindfulness Initiative. One of the areas that was very strong within the Mindful Nation report was criminal justice. And I think this is one of the areas that we need to be putting more resources and time into. But again, it's resources. So it's my job now to find the resources to start this journey, to actually look at how we can actually bring mindfulness into marginalized communities and the communities that need mindfulness the most. Next question is related to the rate of success of this programme and what's been the difficulties and possible shortcomings from the public politicians. I wonder if anybody from the panel would like to quickly respond to that one.
I don't think I understand the question, so sorry to be a bit obtuse.
Yeah, I think maybe Laurentio Nicole Kostrit has asked me to read out the question, and I think it's about the difficulties and possible shortcomings of the programme that's been brought to members of Parliament over this time. Have you seen any difficulties or shortcomings within that programme?
To be honest, I don't think I have. I think that piece of research that Ruth spoke about would be so important to do, the one that asks why is it that people don't keep up their practice. I'm very aware that in the drop-in sessions, the number of people coming to those sessions relative to the number of people who've done the course is, to be honest, pretty small. I mean, it fluctuates, and obviously there are times when people can't come just because of other commitments. But I do think it would be interesting to understand that, whether it is just that it gets crowded out, and we all know how easy that is, or whether there was something that needed almost a greater continuity once a week, where in fact, actually, we're very lucky in Parliament, there's the opportunity of doing it twice a week. But it's not that regular daily practice. And I almost wonder whether, if we had a daily practice, whether that would actually almost counterintuitively mean that people will come more often. I'm not sure. But I think there is a question there about the number of people who go through the programme, and maybe they're just doing it themselves in their homes before they get to Parliament, and why shouldn't they? That's perfectly good, but it would be really lovely to know that.
Thank you, Caroline. The next question is Samuel Pestridge. Would like to ask the question personally. There we are, Samuel.
Hello. It was quite a big question, so do feel free for anyone to just focus on one part of it, or we can just throw it out if people want to get home and go to bed. But yeah, my question was, I'm really interested in what all of the panel, but particularly Jamie, around his work around narrative and his history in marketing, thinks that the most sort of unhelpful and pervasive beliefs around mindfulness, that if were shifted, could possibly open up some possibilities for the Mindful Initiative. So I'm just wondering what he thinks those sort of, or one particularly idea or belief could be. Thanks.
Great question, Samuel. And I think mindfulness has been dogged by misunderstandings and sometimes intentional half-truths and lies in some cases. And those sort of myths or misunderstandings have changed over time. And in fact, there's a section on myth busting in that Building the Case for Mindfulness in the Workplace document Tim held up, because that's so key, particularly in workplace contexts, to challenge some of these existing misunderstandings. But I'd say the one I'd like to dwell on now is a kind of mindfulness being a victim of its own success to some extent, that in order to make it popular, the simplicity of it has been emphasized in many cases. And people, I think, well, that's nice and everything, but it's been sold to me as quite a simple thing that I can take it or leave it. It sounds quite good, but I'm really busy and et cetera. Or it gets really criticized by people who see it as just about a simplistic calm inducing relaxation technique, and it's distracting people from the real problems of the world. They're kind of related, really. And it's based on not seeing how mindfulness is best understood as a natural human capacity that we all have. We just have it to very different degrees, like any strength or quality of mind or body. And that the practices that we can use to cultivate this natural capacity can be very light touch, can be very shallow, or they can be extraordinarily deep and transformative. And that sense of directionality of like, yes, you can get into it in 5 minutes, but this is also something that can completely change almost everything you interact with, because it can so change your relationship to all phenomena and people and yourself, et cetera, et cetera. So I think that's the main one now, where we are in society at the moment. It's kind of been, oh yeah, 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 mindfulness. We've heard about that. We kind of need to say, no, you don't quite get it. Like, yes, you've heard about it, and what you've been told probably is a partial truth. But let's have a big old signpost saying depth this way, and start talking about what the kind of the more profound and long-term benefits are. Thanks, Samuel. Great question.
Yeah, thanks, Samuel. Thanks, Jamie. Next question is from Cesar Saguato.
Hi, thank you. Yeah, Cesare. Thanks for this opportunity and to the Mindfulness Initiative. I'm a mindfulness teacher and psychotherapist and been following the work, and it is mind-blowing what you guys have achieved. So thank you so much to everyone that's working so hard in doing what you're doing. And thank you to the speakers. I've got two questions. The first one's pretty straightforward, and maybe I've missed it along the way, but I'm just wondering, first of all, what mindfulness program MPs have been taken through, because there's a number of different iterations of 8-week courses and so on. So that's the first question. Thank you.
Okay, Ruth, would you like to respond?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that. And there's quite a bit of detail on it on page 14 of the report, just in case you want to look at it afterwards. But the course that started out in Parliament was Finding Peace in a Frantic World, which was based on the programme by Mark Williams and Danny Penman. So that was an 8-week course. And the one that's being taught now by Awareness is called Working Mind, and it's a 6-week course. And I guess linking back to the point Jamie just made about depth, one of our recommendations is that more courses are looked at. So follow-on courses, follow-on workshops, different courses of different lengths for those politicians who do want to go into it in more depth after doing the introductory course.
Thanks, Ruth. Yeah, I'll check that out in the paper. And it leads on to my second question, actually, which is about follow-on courses and depth. So one of the courses I've trained in and I teach is MBCL, which many of you probably know about, mindfulness-based compassionate living, which actually touches in more explicitly some of the things that Caroline and the other speakers have spoken about, looking at what kind of system that we're operating from, fight, flight, freeze, threat, soothing, drive, all of that kind of stuff, developing values and feeling into the suffering of oneself and others and how to respond to that in a wise and skillful way. So my question is, in terms of follow-on courses, are you guys thinking about offering any follow-on courses that are maybe based more in cultivating the qualities of compassion to MPs that have done foundational training that might be interested in doing so in the future? Thank you.
Yeah, I'll answer that really briefly. And the Working Mind course, I think, does go into depth in terms of bringing compassion in and befriending. But there is space, I think, for further developmental courses to be run. But that would be something that the Parliamentary Health and Wellbeing Services team would look at rather than us as clerk to the all-party parliamentary group.
Thank you, Ruth. Thank you, Cesar. Jan Grigg, Mindful Forces. Is Jan, do you want to ask the question directly?
Yeah, it's just a very, very simple question. A lot of us are already big converts to mindfulness and really appreciate all the work that's gone into all of this, the Mindful Nation report. On the ground around the country, it's still quite hard to get funding to actually teach. So we've got a charity and we've got 13 facilitators now. And we actually still find it really, really difficult to get funding to pay all of the facilitators to deliver the work. So it's just something we want. It's just a really practical question. It would be really cool to have a little bit more funding.
Yes, I think that's very true. And I think this echoes the importance of actually getting the decision makers to understand the value of mindfulness and actually taking them on that journey themselves and appreciate that. Does anybody else want to just pop in and say anything about that from the panel?
Shall I say a word, Richard?
Yes, thanks, Tim.
We've a shortage of mindfulness teachers, so we need to train more people. That was one of the early findings that we had. But I think why what we are doing is so important is to provide an evidential base for why mindfulness has benefits across a wide variety of applications. And I mean, as with so many other things, with this shortage of funding, if you can make a strong case that mindfulness has had this impact in rehabilitation of prisoners, in behavioural outcomes in schools or whatever it might be, you're in a stronger position to pitch for funding from wherever you're trying to get it. I mean, within the army, they decided that it was something that they wanted to incorporate in their curriculum, and just did it themselves. I mean, I think there are big opportunities here, and going back to the making sure that you are reaching some of the more harder to reach communities as well, is having this sort of thing available in family hubs, which are now being rolled out, because it's a particular application for parents and young children about fostering better attachment. If you've got this sort of thing available to those communities through family hubs or whatever it may be as well. But you're only going to get that if you can produce the evidence, which is what we've tried to do in the various reports that we've produced so far, to show the impacts and the outcomes that it has. And ultimately, it saves you money, as well as a sort of huge social and health impact it has. You are dealing with problems before they become big problems.
Thanks for all the work that you've all done, though, because it's really helping the rest of us to make a case. So it really gives validity to what it is we're bringing to different areas. So thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Tim, for responding to that one. We've had a comment, I think, from Christine Coker saying it's a fantastic webinar, and the question's for Tim again, I suppose. And it's fantastic that mindfulness is being incorporated into schools, but the concern is that the children are not engaging in this and need social provision within play schemes, and there's not as many providers as there should be because of cuts. This would stem the discontent amongst our youth who are still in school or have left school. Then mindfulness could be extended into this provision so that we can nurture our youth. They are our future. I'm a mindfulness practitioner and work with adults and children. So it's about extending it into after school clubs. What do you think?
Yeah, and it goes back to what I was saying earlier in the applications to education. This is not something that just applies to, inverted commas, naughty children. And that's what makes it so different and such a departure from sort of behavioural programmes that have gone before, where literally, you know, certain pupils who were problematic in whatever way were hauled out of a classroom to go and have whatever professional treatment, you know, support that it was deemed that they needed. What makes this work better is when it's seen as a good thing to do, a fun thing to do that you want to do with all your mates in the class. And I've visited a lot of mindful schools where it's a heavily entrenched part of the school program. Everyone does all the classes together will do their mindfulness practice. And kids start complaining if they don't do it, if there's not time to do it. So it's just a normalized standard enhancement of the school day. Now, by the same token, we should be able to apply it to after school clubs, youth activities in youth clubs or whatever as well. Now, I'm mindful that again, particularly relies on having the instructors there initially to do it. But again, it needs to be demand driven because people want this to happen. Oh, we have this at school. Why can't we have it at Scouts or at the youth club I go to on a Thursday evening or whatever it may be? And particularly where you've got some really innovative youth projects in really difficult and deprived areas as well, to make it a cool thing to do, a normalized thing to do, a routine thing to do, is how you get people to want to adopt it. But then, absolutely, as I say, you've got to have the funds, resources available to get the practitioners to come along and do it. And we need to train so many more of them as well. There is still, although it's great that we've got some practitioners on this call, there's still a big shortage of those practitioners available to go into schools, to go into youth clubs, to go into workplaces, whatever it may be.
Yeah, thanks, Tim. I've got a question from Matthew Springer. Matthew, do you want to ask it in person or would you like me to read it out?
I'm happy to ask it in person. First of all, thank you guys for the wonderful event and the report is superb. The question is basically, I'm just trying to understand how is this program being offered to other governments around the world, and if it is being offered, in what way? Someone has very kindly sent me a link, but that's the question nonetheless.
I'm aware that we've got Chris Ryan on the call. I wonder if Chris would like to wade in on this one. There he is, we've caught you. Don't get away that easily, Chris.
Hi, it was me that just sent the private message to Matthew. So I just mentioned that the Mindfulness Initiative have got an international network. There are either politicians or mindfulness advocates with political links in 50 countries around the world. We've managed to introduce them mindfulness to about 10 parliaments through the Mindfulness Initiative, for including the Sweden and Tim in Congress did it by themselves. So not all of those programs have continued. So it's out there. There are about six or seven countries that are trying to introduce it as we speak. We meet three times a year. We pick up best practice from around the world. And then we share it. So it's a thriving network, and we're coming up with some great ideas. Mindfulness for the civil servants as well as the politicians. Mindfulness for mayors at a city level. And that we've got Kelly Boyce on here today, who's taking mindful cities forward in the US as well. So there's a lot going out there. If you want to drop me a line, I'll expand further.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
Thank you. And of course, if there's anybody out there who wants to bring mindfulness forward into their legislature in their own country, because I noticed looking at the participants, we've got people from many different places around the globe, please do contact the Mindfulness Initiative and we'll be able to give you support and guidance around that. So that's great. Just before we deal with the last few questions, because I'm conscious that we're running over, because Eileen just put into the chat a link to the actual mindfulness report, just if anybody hasn't had it yet. But also a link to our website so that you can see other resources that we've actually got online that would be useful in terms of looking at our work. And I'm not going to apologise for this, a link to how you could donate to our work. None of our work is funded by government or from statutory sources. And if we're going to expand our work and reach further and reach communities that so far haven't been reached by mindfulness and draw the policy down to those communities and create an environment where funding can flow to support the mindfulness teachers that are being trained, that are waiting in the community to deliver programs, then we need support and we need funding to do that. So I'm going to put a link in the chat to if you can give a donation to us, that'd be fantastic. So the last couple of questions, now I'm conscious that we've had lots of comments come through in the chat, and obviously I'd encourage you to read those as we go through, and I'm not going to go through every single comment that we've had, but they're there for everybody to see. But Jackie Gardner Nix would like to ask a question. So Jackie, are you around?
Yes, I am. Hi, from Canada. So I'm a physician mindfulness facilitator and happy to report that in Ontario, where I come from, the health program here does cover mindfulness for my patients, so I can offer programs covered, which is lovely. But I find that 80% of mindfulness programs are the gender, those who identify as female are part of the 80% of the programs. Only 20% males join the programs, unless we're running a veterans program or an addictions program. And I wondered if you were seeing that too, because I've talked about this with others at international conferences and they're seeing the same thing. So what are we doing that's not attracting those who identify as male into our programs?
That's a really interesting question. I think it's something that we see reflected over here as well. Does anybody from the panel wish to step in?
I don't think it's been a big thing in Parliament, and I'm not conscious that, well, actually, one of the courses I did go on, there are only five of us, I was the only man on that one. But otherwise, it's pretty well balanced, and we've had, well, we've currently got a male and female co-chairs and a good mix of officers. So it's not something, I may be wrong, others may kick in, but it's not something I've ever been conscious of here.
No, okay. I mean, I'd underline that. Yeah, I think there is a slight skew, but it isn't that evident when we're in meetings. It's not something I considered that closely, like Tim.
Thank you, Jamie. Okay, Shmika van der Laan has a question. Would you like to ask it in person, or would you like me to read it out? I'll read it out. How far away do you think is starting a meeting with a 3-minute breathing space or just a 1 minute? Presumably that refers to meetings in Parliament. Can we see a time when that's going to happen?
Absolutely. This isn't too far away, in as much as there is already a prayer at the beginning of the day. I mean, Tim right. can say more about this. There have been suggestions that might, you know, that's a, you know, precious and sacred thing for many people, that there might want to be some variance in that, or at least you say, you know, we already have a precedent here, we could, you know, at other points in the day have a short pause. I'm aware that there is some evidence about how even short pauses before meetings increase their effectiveness in various ways. So I think an evidence-based approach to the Speaker of the House of Commons or whoever it needs to be, Tim, isn't too far-fetched, do you think?
Well, look, I mean, as Jamie says, we have, at the start of every day in the House of Commons, we have 5 minutes of prayers where the Speaker and the Speaker's chaplain and the sergeants process in, and then we go through a set of Christian prayers. Now, some people don't approve of that. It's not compulsory, but there is a benefit. In order to save your seat for the day, you have to be at prayers. That doesn't mean to say you have to do the prayers. Some people will sit there mindfully thinking about other things. So we sort of do that preface to the day before we then get stuck in. And there is a case for saying, well, okay, Christian prayers, that's a bit eclectic these days, isn't it? Or you're only looking at a minority. Maybe I'm not expressing any views there. So why shouldn't you do a bit of reflection, which is instead what we do with mindfulness? The principle is the same. So nobody could say in response, oh no, we couldn't do anything like that. That would, you know, that would wreck the whole program. Well, it wouldn't. It just means that instead of doing 5 minutes of prayers, we're doing 3, 4, 5 minutes of grounding ourselves, doing a mindfulness practice. So I'm not saying I'm going to go to the Speaker and suggest that, because there'll be all sorts of people jump up and down about it, but it would seem to me a natural progression. And for those other institutions who don't start with something like that, then why wouldn't it be a good suggestion? Just so you've got the room's attention. You're all on the same wave length. It's a good way of starting a meeting. We always do it with our all-party group meetings. There are others that, you know, I think could adopt that too.
Thank you, Tim. Thank you, Jamie. I'm conscious that we could probably continue all night, and we're losing people as we go on, and that's completely understandable because we're now at 6:45. But I would like to thank all the speakers this evening for giving up your time and also giving personal insights into the role of mindfulness. In terms of how that interacts with your political and personal life. And I think that's a real insight moving forward. And when we look at mindfulness in politics, we remind ourselves that this isn't just about enabling people to manage stress within a toxic environment, It's actually about enabling people to be better leaders, to lead us better, to make better decisions, to make more considered and appropriate and creative decisions through open-hearted listening. And therefore, we should see that filter down into the decisions that are made in Parliament. And I think, you know, that's where we need to map this. This is where we need to go now in terms of looking at that change, looking at that transformation of politics. It's not just inner work for individuals to make them feel better in that environment. It's actually about what makes them better politicians and better leaders for us all. And with an election coming up, perhaps more electable as well, to be honest. But just to leave you with that thought. So thank you very much. Thank you to our speakers. I do appreciate it. You know where you are if you need us. The link's been put into the chat for our website. Thank you again. Thank you. Thank you for coming.